Medina is a very welcoming town or city, and the Islamic University students, you are even most welcome. I first enjoyed your company the first time I visited you, and was the center of an award. From that moment, I pledged myself that whenever you call, whether it is day or night, rain or shine, whatever it is, I will stop whatever I'm doing and make my way right here to be part of
you.
It is commendable that you've been able to organize something like this. And I hope that this will not be the last time, but the first of many series of lectures. And I hope that next time you will have a more important personality than myself who would come here and address you.
Inshallah.
I have decided to come, and when I was called, the first thing that came to my mind was, what should I talk about? And I thought, well, you are here studying Islamic studies. Your language of instruction is Arabic. But you all come from a country whose official language is English. And so there is often some gaps in the knowledge, especially for those of us who studied in English-speaking countries and live in English countries. We have a certain level of understanding about how systems work. But most importantly, in my life of work as a lawyer, I engage a lot with Ghanaian communities in the United Kingdom and other African citizens living in the United Kingdom. I represent many of them in their immigration work, because that is one of my areas of specialty. And based on my experience and the problems that we encounter as lawyers who have to deal with immigrants, I have decided that I will share that knowledge with you, because you are tomorrow's leaders. At the end of your studies, you are all going to go back home to your communities. Your communities are going to be looking up to you for answers. And so in order to balance your knowledge, I decided that I'll prepare this lecture and attend here and then share those experiences with you. Because I believe strongly, with that background, it will help you to be able to engage with your communities in a more productive way. Now, we are all Ghanaians. And before I go into the detail of today's lecture, there are two things I would want you to bear in mind. The first one is contract. Contract is what keeps the world going round. All relationships are defined by contract. We here are Muslims, and so we have an agreement with our Creator. The terms of that agreement is the Holy Quran. So if anybody is confused about anything in this world, and they ask you, you don't give your opinion. You tell them, let's look at what the Quran says, isn't it? So whatever the Quran says, that's what we are going to follow. So our relationship with our Creator, the terms are entrenched in the Quran. Nobody can add anything, and no one can take anything out. It is the same with all other relationships in the world. Contract and agreements is what keeps the world going round. The second thing I would want you to bear in mind is what we call a legal entity. A legal entity is anybody who can enter into an agreement with another person, anyone who can be sealed, or be sealed. Anybody who can seal and be sealed is a legal entity. And I give you this definition because it is not all legal entities that are human beings. Some legal entities are not human beings. Companies are legal entities. Finally, to start my conversation with you today, is organization, which is what this topic is all about. Organization is the most important thing in this world. Organization is what brings about progress. The difference between rich countries and poor countries is organization. Your studies are well organized for you. Letters are organized into words, words into sentences, sentences into chapters, chapters into topics, and topics into subjects. It's all well organized. And so you build on what has been organized, and then you progress. So organization leads to progress. The opposite is also true. Disorganization leads to chaos. So where there is disorganization, there is no progress. And to give you an example, to take the most successful people in this life and in this world are people who are organized. The most unsuccessful people are very disorganized. And so when a person's mind is disorganized, they can't achieve anything. They become burdens on society. And in the worst case scenario of disorganization, it's chaos. So when a person's mind is completely disorganized, they become mad. They don't know what they're doing. They don't know what they're talking about. So disorganization is the worst thing that will happen to anyone, any community, or any country. So the difference between developed countries and what we call developing countries is all about organization. All developed countries are well-organized countries. They are well-organized communities. All of them, and all of them have the same features. So I live in a very developed country. I live in the United Kingdom, and I've lived in the United Kingdom for more than, when I left Ghana, Rollins was still in power. So I've been around for a very long time, I've been away for a very long time. And I've seen most of the world. So I can tell you on the top that all developed countries have the same features. If I travel to any developed country, it's very easy for me to navigate the country because I know what I'm looking for and I know where to go and find what I'm looking for. In developing countries like Ghana, it's not the same. They are disorganized countries. And whenever a country is disorganized, there is a lot of suffering. There's lack of progress. Crime is very high. People are miserable. There are no opportunities. And these are the symptoms of a disorganized society. Before I left the UK, just the day before I left, 27 immigrants trying to enter the UK drowned in what we call the Channel, the water between the UK and France, because they were on a boat, something we call a dinghy, trying to enter the UK, and 27 of them got drowned. Now, this is a sad story, but I'll tell you this. This happens every day in the Mediterranean. The Mediterranean is taking our people every single day. Why? Because they are trying to escape from a disorganized society into an organized society. They are running away from lack of opportunity to look for places where there are opportunities. Some of them are running from not disorganized countries, but countries that are chaotic. They've gone beyond disorganization into chaos. When chaos reigns, there is confusion. People kill each other. So Syria is in chaos now. Libya is in chaos now. That is the worst case of disorganization. So, like I said, organization is the most important thing. Whether you're a human being, if you will succeed in this life, it starts with organization. If you will fail in this life, it starts with organization. All successful people are well-disciplined people. They are well-organized people. They know what they want out of life, and they are busy getting it. Disorganized people don't know what they are looking for. So they indulge in cheap gossips, in unnecessary things, and if you look around them, they have no opportunities because they don't know what they want out of life. So I'm going to tell you about organization. And I started by saying Ghana is a very disorganized country. I'll tell you why. We are all Ghanaians. When we say we are Ghanaians, what does it mean? What is Ghana? We all know Ghana is a country, and we are Ghanaians. But what does it mean? Ghana, as a country, is different from the people in it. Ghana, as a country, is different from the people who live in Ghana. The country is a legal entity in its own right. And I started by saying the legal entity is anyone who can sue and be sued. It's got features like a human being. So Ghana has features like a human being. That is why somebody can live, a Nigerian can live in Ghana, but he's not a Ghanaian. And we don't call Ghanaians Ghana. We call them Ghanaians, not Ghana. The two are different. And if you understand the distinction, then you understand everything about organization. So Ghana is a legal entity. It's got its own features, just like a body. The body of Ghana is the country, the land. The top from Hamle to Boku area or the Kaga area, all the way down to the coastal area, and up to 12 nautical miles, which is about 22, 23 kilometers, into the sea. That is the landmass of Ghana. That is the physical body of Ghana. Ghana, as a legal entity, has its uniform. Every country has a uniform. You can identify a soldier from a soldier's uniform, a policeman from his uniform, a doctor from what they wear, isn't it? Ghana has its uniform. The uniform is the red, gold, green, and the black star in the middle. The flag of the country is the uniform of the country. So whenever you see the flag flying, you know Ghana is there. Am I right?
Hey.
But human beings have spirits. Because I am talking now, you can't see the words, but you can hear me. It's the same thing. Ghana has its own spirit. The spirit of Ghana is its expression. It tells you what kind of person is Ghana. What kind of person is it? The spirit of Ghana you would find in the national anthem. So when Ghanaians sing the national anthem, what do they say? They say, God bless our homeland, Ghana, isn't it? Well, what that tells you is that the spirit of Ghana believes in God. It is a spirit that believes in God. In God. If you recite the Ghanaian pledge, the final one says, so help me God. And you will see this when you visit Ghana and speak in any Ghanaian language. If you greet an Ashanti man and ask an Ashanti, etisen, what do they say? Yamiyabu, isn't it? You meet a Hausa man and you say, Yadi, do you go Allah? Oh, alhamdulillah, isn't it? You meet a Dagomba person and you say Kadubiwula. Oh yeah, well, now you go. It cuts across in all the languages. The spirit of Ghana therefore lives in God. So quite recently I was watching an interview where Sam George was being interviewed by CNN. And they were asking him, what do you mean by the values of Ghana? Well, what Sam George was trying to tell CNN and the world is that Ghana believes in God, and therefore anything that is against the ways of God is unacceptable in the country. That is the whole message he was trying to tell them. And human beings have gender. We are either a man or a woman. And so is countries. Every state in the world has a gender. We consider all states in the world as women. They are female. We use feminine for countries. And the reason is because women procreate. They bring forth children, isn't it? And whatever you give a woman, they will multiply it. You give a woman 100 cows, you come home, there is a lot of food for you to eat. That is their nature. It's the same thing with the earth. You plant one seed, it will give you a tree. And so countries are considered as women. They are considered feminine. That is why we always say Ghana, my motherland. So Ghana is a mother. And Ghanaians are the children of Ghana. All Ghanaians. We are about 30 million of us. We are all the children of Ghana. And this is very important. As a state and a mother, Ghana has no grandchildren. It only has children. So everyone in Ghana, born in Ghana, and is a child of Ghana, is called a Ghanaian. There is a reason for that. The reason is this. When a woman gives birth to a child in Ghana, what happens? After they give the child a name, they take care of the child, protect the child, but they also do something. They will get the child a birth certificate, isn't it?
Yeah.
Ghana gives the child a birth certificate. The birth certificate is the one most important document that every Ghanaian child should have. And I'm just going to tell you this. If you visit any country where some people have no birth certificates, then that is a very disorganized country. It is the first thing you will notice about disorganized countries. Because the birth certificate is the first most important document that every child should have. The reason the birth certificate is given to the child is because it is the proof of contract between the child and the mother Ghana. It's more like, even though you were given birth by your parents, Ghana has also delivered you as a child. And the proof that Ghana has delivered you as his child is the birth certificate. But because Ghana, as a nation, didn't deliver you naturally like your mother did, it cannot call you my child. So it says you are my citizen. So citizen of a country is the same as being a child of the country. Do you now understand? Good. We are making progress. Now, just like a mother has responsibilities towards their children, what responsibilities do women have? When you come, your mother will breastfeed you, nurture you, clothe you, shelter you, protect you, and make sure you grow up. They would want you to have education, they would start teaching you when you are still a baby how to behave.
Kind of what you need to go for now.
Ghana as a state owes you the same responsibilities like your mother. The same responsibilities. To make sure that all its citizens, not some, all its citizens have education. It is to make sure that all its citizens are protected, including their properties, within the country. It is the responsibility of Ghana to make sure that if no external person can come in and harm you, it is the responsibility of Ghana to make sure that you can travel around Ghana freely and quickly. It is the responsibility of Ghana that you work, you have a job, you are employed. It is its responsibility. It is the responsibility of Ghana to make sure that if you want to travel outside of Ghana, it will give you all that you need to be able to embark on your journey. And when you are outside Ghana, it is still the responsibility of Ghana to protect you and make sure that your needs are met. Do you understand? But how does Ghana do that? How does Ghana do that? Ghana does these things by creating institutions. It creates institutions, and the institutions are what we call the government. It creates a government, a parliament, which is a legislature, and a judiciary, which are the courts. Now, the government is supposed to deliver all these things to you through its agencies. The branches are like the Ministry of Agriculture has a responsibility to make sure that there is a lot of food in Ghana. That is the whole reason why it's been set up. The Ministry of Health has the responsibility to make sure that all Ghanaians are healthy and they have access to good health. That is the reason it was set up. The Ministry of Interior has the responsibility to make sure that all Ghanaians are well protected. Because the police come under the Ministry of Interior. Are you with me? The Ministry of Defense has the responsibility to protect you against any external aggression. Whether by land, by sea, or the air. That is their responsibility. So all these ministries, the Ministry of Transport is to make sure that Ghanaians will be able to move around Ghana, whether by air, whether by sea, whether by the rivers, or by roads, to get from point A to point B quickly and safely. That is the responsibility of the Ministry of Transport. So all the ministries are created to serve Ghanaians. And so, now, many Ghanaians have a feeling that something is wrong somewhere, but they can't quite pinpoint what is wrong. Recently, you heard people demonstrating, telling the president to fix the country. Well, what they are saying, literally, is that the institutions are not working, they are not doing what they are supposed to do, because there is a lot of unemployment. That's all they're saying. So make sure the institutions work. Okay. Isn't it? Now there is a reason the institutions are not working. And the reason the institutions are not working is because the country is a disorganized country. I told you from the beginning of this lecture that in every relationship is a contract. And the contract is often written down, just like it happened for us. It's the same thing with Ghana and her citizens. The relationship between Ghana and the citizens is in the constitution of Ghana. The constitution sets out everything you can do as a Ghanaian and what you cannot do as a Ghanaian. It also sets out the duties of Ghana to you. But the sad thing here is that when you break any of the laws, which is if you fail to do what Ghana does, if you do something that Ghana tells you not to do, it will not forgive you. It will punish you, isn't it? I'll give you an example. The Ghanaian law says you should not steal. If you steal, do you think Ghana will forgive you? No, it will punish you. They will arrest you and take you to court. From court, if you are convicted, you go to prison. So, how come that if Ghana doesn't play its role or doesn't play its part of the contract by doing what it is supposed to do, how come that we are not able to punish it? Now, that is the problem, and that is the reason why the country is not the problem. I will explain this in detail. But before I do, I'll just briefly digress to tell you something about birth certificates. In my work, I went as a lawyer. There are full grown Ghanaians now in the UK. They come to my office. Some of them will come and if they are about to fill for, I'll ask, what is your date of birth? What is your name? Your date of birth? And then they'll tell me, what is your mother's name? They'll tell me. What is your mother's date of birth? They don't know. I don't know my mother. My mother is dead. Your mother is dead. Have you got the death certificate? No, we don't have it. We don't register the death. Can I see your birth certificate? The birth certificate will show that somebody who was born in 1980, the birth certificate was issued around 2019. Now, you wouldn't understand that it is disgraceful. It's appalling and it shouldn't happen. The major problems Ghanaians face in the UK, not just Ghanaians, all African countries. Sometimes they want to bring their children from Ghana. They will apply for a visa, we do everything properly. They will send the application and the UK government or the US government We said, no, we are not going to give you the visa. The reason, the birth certificate shows it was issued 14 years after the child was born. So we do not accept that this is a proper document that proves the relationship. And they will go on and say that the U.S. State Department report about Ghana shows that it is very easy to get the birth certificate. In other words, they consider our birth certificate as a reliable document. The knock-on effect of these things I'm telling you here, it might look simple, but it costs a lot of money for people to do this application. It costs thousands of pounds for them to make the application. Only to be told they will give you, your child will not come and join you because of the death certificate. And everything they say about Ghana, about how easy it is to obtain a death certificate, is true, it's not a lie. It's a fact. And because their system is so well organized, they don't understand why somebody who was born in 1980 would produce a person that was registered in 2019. What we then have to do is to go on and do a DNA test. When we do this DNA test, if it's a woman and her children, we don't even have a problem. It's okay, we are confident, but it is going to cost another £500. If it is a father and his children, then we start praying. Especially if there are about 3 or 4 children, because the results will come, 3 and 1 is all it. So you see the problems that this is creating. Sometimes I have had big men, I'm talking about big men who have spent all their life looked after a child up to the age of 15 years. They love their children, want to bring them. They struggle. And then the DNA test will come and say the child is not yours. They cry like little babies. Why? Because what was the DNA test in the first place? Yes. Birth certificate. Because the birth certificate has no respect. And that's what I'm telling you. I'm telling you this on authority. I am a lawyer and I work in business every day of my life. They have no respect. There are numerous times I'm supposed to stand up in court to argue about our birth certificate. Because they were changed in 2009. And became effective in 2011. Now, to even get the information about how the birth certificate and why the birth certificate were changed, I can't find it on any Ghanaian government website. It is a Canadian, a regular United Nations website. Where the information is. And it is so embarrassing times before it died to try to explain these things to a foreign judge who has no respect for your birth certificate. And I am a Ghanaian. So, this is why I am telling you that the country is what? It's all
right.
Now, you will all soon go and work as community leaders in Ghana. When our women give birth to children, don't just go and do dua for them. It's a responsibility now when you to make sure that they register what? That child's birth within a few weeks after the child has been born. It's something you have to do. I told you it is the responsibility of Ghana as a country to educate every Ghanaian. It is. Not some Ghanaians. All Ghanaians must have access to good education. The country's duty to do that.
When you have finished your
education, or before you finish your education, as soon as you reach the age of 18, which is usually the age of
marriage,
that's when you
start to get your job.
Ghana as a country is supposed to give you what we call the social security number. Right? The purpose of the social security number is because the country has to prepare you for a working life. If you start working, that is the first thing you give to any employer, anybody who gives you a job. Because they have to deduct social security contributions. So that when you are not able to work, the government can continue to pay you some money and you find another job. When you are injured and completely unable to work because of some before me, you should not be dependent on anybody. The government should be able to take care of you for the rest of your life. Sure. Similarly, when you reach the age of 65 and you retire,
no,
you
are
no longer working. The government is supposed to pay you pension. Now, I can bet that most of you don't have children. Why? Because the country is a very disorganized country. And it is cheating.
Not the one.
The reason you don't have it is because it is food for the few people who are managing the resources.
It's cheating.
Every Ghanaian child from the age of 18 must have this activity now. Now let me give you another video. Take two people, you and me. We are all Ghanaians, we are all citizens of Ghana. You know, we have the core rights. I go to
more than 10 years.
An English school in Ghana, you go to an Arabic school. We are the same age. At the age of 20, we finish. I applied for a job in Ghana, maybe because my father works more, I get a job. Whatever the government pays me, the government
is making that
decision. You don't get the job. You don't work for anybody. The government doesn't pay you anything. Every 4 years, we all go to vote, isn't it? When it's voting time, you need my vote, you need your vote. We keep voting. I vote. Through maybe family contributions, you will get some capital. And set yourself up to do some small business. You do the process from your business to support your children. You go to school, you pay their school fees. Then we all grow old. I get to 65. Your business, so you're no longer strong enough to work again, so maybe you give up the business. You stay home. Every month, the government pays me a pension. You don't get nothing. Why? Why should you not get something? Are you not a citizen of Ghana? Were you not voting all your life? So for all the years you've been voting, what have you been voting for? What have you been voting for? The pension is not for people who work for the Ghana government. The pension is for every Ghanaian from 65 years must have a pension. The reason they don't have pension is because of one thing. I'll tell you what it is. And I'll tell you why the country is a very disorganized country. And until the country is fixed, even if you bring Obama to rule that country, it will never develop. It's impossible. Because what I'm telling you now are the conditions that the building blocks that ever developed under. I live in the UK. I work as a lawyer. I pay my taxes. Not just taxes and national insurance. I pay them. I still pay my personal tax because of where I live. I'm not worried. If I lose a job, if I'm not able to work, and I can't pay my rent, I'll call the place we call the job center plus. I'll tell them, I've lost my job, I can't work anywhere, I don't have any job, I can't pay my rent, I don't. They will start paying money to buy food and eat and pay my rent until I get another job.
Inshallah.
Do you understand?
Yes.
Why? Because it's a well-organized society. I don't, if they'll test me, they'll find out why I can't. Meanwhile, they'll be trying to help me find a job at the same time. Because they are paying me, they don't want to be paying people. So they'll help you to find a job. The reason there is unemployment in Ghana is because the government is not paying them. If the government were paying Ghanaian citizens, the graduates who are finished school, unemployment benefits, all of them will be working right now. Ghana will find jobs for them. And don't tell me Ghana is not paying them because Ghana is poor. Ghana is not a poor country. Take it from me. Ghana is not a poor country. I'll tell you why. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
If I was an important personality in Ghana making decisions, it's not just the social security numbers that you will get. I will make sure that when you are 18 years old, you will have to give you your first bank account as a country. And put in at least 10 Ghana cedis inside your bank account. For starters. They will go hand in hand. Pension. Okay, I'm entitled to my pension when I retire. Even though I'm self-employed, I still have pension because if you're self-employed, you still have to pay the national insurance contribution. And they will tell you when you will stop paying. Okay. Yeah, I know where I'm going to stop paying. That is a well-organized society. And the reason these things are not happening is because Ghana is refusing to live up to its responsibilities. And it is doing so because they know that many of you do not understand the relationship between Ghana and Ghanaians. Do you understand where I'm coming from?
Very well.
If you get married to a woman, whether one or two, Ghana is supposed to recognize that marriage. And so Ghana will have to issue you a marriage certificate. Every time it issues you a certificate, it's a recognition. When you pass your exams, you get a certificate, isn't it? It's the same thing with the state, your relationship with the state. Your relationship with the university is that at the end of your course, they give you something, a certificate, as evidence that you have studied here and you have passed. The state has to recognize you at every stage in your development. So when you get married, the state must give you a marriage certificate. It is a very important document. And this, just like the birth certificate, is creating a lot of problems for Ghanaians overseas. Because they marry, they say, that's my husband. They fill forms and say, that is, we are married. When did you marry? Where did you? Where is your marriage certificate? Hey, it was a traditional marriage. We just took drinks to my husband's family brought me, and my family accepted it. Okay. Where is the proof? Where is the evidence? There is no certificate. Yeah? I'll come back on some of these things again as we progress. When you apply that to you. Right. When you expire, when you die, Ghana is supposed to issue you a death certificate, but you are no more alive, so they have to give it to your family members. In the same way as they gave your birth certificate to your parents when you didn't know anything, they now give your parents death certificates to you as proof that they are no more alive. The final thing I'll tell you about well-organized countries and very disorganized countries like Ghana is when I started, I told you the body of Ghana is the land, isn't it?